Hey guys, and welcome back to Shantae and the Pirate's Curse. In this part, we're going through Propeller Town, which is not my favorite area in the game, if we're going to be 100% honest here. Fuck this place.
Let's not be honest. This is a great level. This is a great area. It's the most amazing area of gaming history.
Well, it's not like it's awful or anything. Like, I'll gladly go through this place before going through Mudbog, because the enemies aren't as much of a pain in the ass, but it's a very open area, so I always feel like I'm missing something in here, which is, you know.
The war mechs never gave me any trouble.
Oh, no, you can scimitar them without any problems whatsoever.
Goody, it's everyone's favorite heart squid.
I can never remember what the order is for this.
It's the middle one, I remember that one.
It starts with the middle, but I always forget which one it is, so
I just look it up every time.
Well, oh man, you're smarter than I am. I usually just do some sort of bullshit trial and error.
That's what I do all the time.
Yeah, until I kind of stumble upon the right answer.
You're shooting for that green one that's right there on that right upper right there.
Yeah.
So that you can go left and shoot at the red one that automatically launches you downward. But yeah, the fact that you can't really see where you're going until it's too late. Yeah, her sentiments exactly.
She's
doing the space jump.
Yeah, speed. So I'm speeding up all of my failed attempts at this area because it sucks.
Fun fact about this song, you can actually get the official MP3 for free through the Kickstarter page, or is it through the actual singer's
it might be
on YouTube?
It might be through Jake Kaufman, because he gives away almost all of his music for free. So you can get it somewhere. Not pirating it for once. So,
yeah, it's just a really good free song.
Pirating.
It's the main theme of Half Genie Hero.
Yeah, it's actually sung. It's actually sung by the voice of Shantae in this game.
Oh really?
Yeah, Christina V is her name. It's Shantae's voice singing. So.
Now yeah. I really wish the Kickstarter would reach that goddamn voice acting stretch goal.
It would have been great.
Okay.
So I'm assuming this is a successful attempt?
Yeah, this is our successful attempt. I guess it wouldn't be so goddamn hard if it was zoomed out just a little bit more.
There you go.
Yay.
Heart Squido.
Goodbye, crew world. Fuck this place. I hate Propeller Town.
The rest of the area isn't nearly as bad as that one room, but it's a little bit annoying because you do have to come back here after you get the cannon. But thankfully it's in the same island. So if you just got a pirate flare on standby, then it's not that bad.
Best upgrade in the game in this place, I would say. I love the cannon. Yeah, the triple jump.
Well, it basically makes all of your other upgrades to this point useless. There's a reason why it's the last one given to you. Like, just for shits and giggles, I did most of a pirate mode run, and I honestly had to stop partway through because, you know, as fun as it is to break the game like that, part of the reason why I like games like this is that you progressively get stronger as you play the game, so starting with all of your abilities is just weird. Like, I don't get the same feeling I do, like, doing a new game plus in an RPG.
You're playing pirate mode for speedrunning purposes.
Yeah.
Most likely.
That's basically it.
In pirate mode, do you have the pirate outfit thing going on?
No, in pirate mode, you basically just have all the pirate weapons from the get-go, so you can go through the game really quickly. But you don't have, like, any difference to your sprite, which is sad, but, you know. It is how it is.
Yeah.
So does Shantae know how to swing a sword?
Nah.
She
like
know.
All she does is pogo stick on it.
Yep.
And stab.
Well, who needs to swing a sword when you've got magic hair? Right.
It's like, you know, if Risky could see how she was using this sword, she would be so furious.
Like, her hair probably has more range than the sword does, all things considered.
Safe bet. Yeah,
yeah, but they could have made up for that by making the sword more powerful. Kind of like how God of War made up for the sword's lack of range by making it more powerful.
But doesn't everybody just use the Blades of Chaos in that game anyway?
Well, yeah, because they cover such a goddamn large area, but the two-handed sword that you get later on has a much higher damage output. So if you're
supposed to speed boost through this area.
Yeah, but I had to fight the enemy first, so...
You would have killed them on the way.
You can run and kill them at the same time.
Well, yeah. The mech is too close to you in order for you to get it by speed boosting, I believe.
And so I
run forward to kill that one, and then... Son of a bitch!
Nonsense, you're just not closing your eyes before you run.
Also, it's okay, because I jumped down the pit, and now I can go over to this side, no problem.
but if you land before falling in the pit,
Jump into the pit.
Yeah, it just responds to where you entered the room.
Or you can backtrack the long way if you hate yourself.
For a second, I thought it looked like you flew off the edge of the screen and fell through the platform.
It might have been doing some graphical weirdness. I'm not really sure. Again, I recorded this game like a day or two after it came out on the Wii U. And I believe this was only like my second or third full playthrough of the game, so I'm not 100% familiar with how everything's supposed to go yet. So that's why it's a somewhat sloppy playthrough. I understand that, but I do get everything eventually. So if you're
progress, that's all that really matters to me, honestly.
Yeah. Yep.
Unless you like want to specifically say that, hey, I'm gonna play this game to the best of my fucking ability, and then I'm gonna amaze you guys. Support my Patreon. No, that's not us.
Yeah, so Bolo ended up being the Techno Baron's assistant the entire time.
Because he has glasses.
Yeah.
Another Shantae 1 remix in the background.
This is the
theme that plays when you're in the pumpkin fields.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I think it might be. I actually feel really bad for Bolo here, because he's like, you're my friend, right? And you know that's giving this... You really don't want to... like, be a dick to Bolo, but you know, giving this to the ammo baron means he's gonna blow something up. So, yeah.
Well.
Yeah, that's awkward.
I thought I was in Propeller Town.
I cut past anything unimportant that I've
done. This rabbit hole goes deep.
Wait, does Shantae do this sort of sound if you spend too long in the shop?
Yep. It's actually a little bit annoying because you can't scroll down to the bottom of the screen before she says it. So it's like
she's most likely to do it more often than not. I had some times where I scrolled down, she didn't make a noise, but the moment I decided to hit up, I'm not indecisive. I know what I want. I just accidentally passed it.
Well, yeah, but have you ever gone to the store looking for something specific and wound up browsing along the way and wanting to get something else and you're trying
Everybody
to decide
window
whether to
shops.
Go? Basically every trip to GameStop I've ever made ever.
I always take a look at the used games just in case something managed to worm its way in there.
Wait, who's locked in the palace?
Oh, Ammo Baron. He's going to blow it up so he can take over the wild.
He's aiming for the Royal Library.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
And he misses completely.
The targeting module was faulty. Well.
The Techno Baron. And that's how you get into the next dungeon.
Wasn't even green.
Oh man, that's good.
I have a hard time like trying to interrupt the dialogue because this scene's great.
That's one thing Wave 4 really knows how to do, right? Is comedic writing.
Yeah.
Complete obliteration
save
the
day.
Fourth wall. So, that stretch goal was met, wasn't it?
Yeah, Bolo mode. Bolo mode, Sky mode, and Roddy Top's mode were all the same stretch goal.
Yeah.
So
if we take control of Bolo, we're firing incorrectly targeted missiles.
Well, he has like a mace thing.
So, what you need to do is always aim for the enemy next to the one you want to hit.
I suppose. Well, that's only if you can put on his glasses, though.
Oh, look, it's the dragons from the fire level. They're blue now.
Oh no, they were actually here when we first saw them.
They're also back from Shantae 1.
Is this song a remix of anything?
No. I love the factory qualities of it though. You do get a mechanical sense out of this theme.
Oh yeah, this is a great song, and it's one of my favorite dungeons in the game too.
Also very not very long either.
No, it's pretty short, all things considered. Yeah, like this part would have been 15 minutes, but all of the pre-dungeon stuff was only 9, and I didn't want to do a less than 10 minute part because it's not 2007 anymore. So yeah, that's why you get an extra dose of brain scratch comms with your Wheaties this morning, kids.
You probably didn't take this into account when you made the video this long, but you actually can't change ad settings on a video that's less than 10 minutes long.
Yes, totally meant to do that. Right.
Always thinking one step ahead. He lied through his teeth.
The bubble shield makes this place pretty inconsequential, because if you've got one, like, most of the enemies here shoot projectiles to hurt you, so if you've got a bubble shield, like, you basically just can't take damage, unless if you walk into something, like a dumbass.
You were trying to avoid using it, weren't you?
No, I think I was just like, oh, right, I've got bubble shields. I've probably got, like, 9 of them stocked up at this point. So.
I could press the I win button. Or I could give myself a harder time.
Why would you do that second time part one though? Like, really?
Challenge mode.
Yeah, or if you got something to prove. I don't know who you're proving it to.
Apparently, though, the bubble shield doesn't protect you from explosions. So
I suppose you'd be proving it to the obnoxious brat in the comment section who won't shut up about every little thing you do wrong in the game.
Yeah, but who cares about him, right?
It could be a her. You never know. Probably a him, though.
You know, the worst part is that you actually find out who that person is. He's probably a billionaire that has way better living standards than you do. Well, fuck you too, buddy.
These enemies are weird. I'm pretty sure this is the only room in the game that they're in.
Interesting.
They're not all that hard, too, so I guess they just had leftover assets and decided, fuck it.
You hit them once and they collapse, and then you just attack the carcass.
Yeah, but if you're crouching to start, you don't have to do anything, really.
You think maybe they were meant for an earlier dungeon, but they decided while they were making it that it didn't fit the aesthetic of the place?
Yeah.
If they were going to fit an aesthetic, it would probably be Spittle Maze.
Probably. They're not very hard, too, so they probably were designed for that area and just, plopped somewhere else for enemy variety's sake. Now you can actually, if you've got the, if you're quick on the draw with the hat, you can just kind of jump off the thing early and go over and float over the spiky blocks, as opposed to trying to climb up and down the ladder Donkey Kong Country style and dodge the stuff. So it is an option, but you have to get back on it quick, because if you're not on it for a certain amount of time, it disappears. So.
Whoa!
No, you gotta put the setting on low. Start slow and then you build yourself up to high speed.
Floor it?
No.
Floor it!
There we go.
Despite 10 early damage,
do you do more damage with every hit? Or
Yeah, it's not really that big of a deal, though, because, like, most enemies, if you're either going to kill them in one hit, or they're not worth going back to kill. So, you know, but...
Yeah. In the case of those big enemies, they die in one hit anyway.
Yeah.
You're using the cannon like Lady uses her bazooka in Devil May Cry 4 Special Edition.
Yeah, you...
That's Lady's double jump in Special Edition. She just fires a rocket downward, and it counts as an attack.
Well, you get a quadruple... You essentially get a quadruple jump here. Because you can shoot up, you can jump and then use the cannonball 3 times. And you don't get as much height as, like, a normal jump in with the cannonball, but you do, you essentially get, like, I'd say about 3 times the jump height. So you can, you basically have quite a fuck ton of
not aerial quite maneuver. Space jump.
Well, the space jump allows you to jump infinitely, John.
No, I'm just categorizing it. Not quite Space Jump. But you still get incredible distances with it.
Yeah. Since Shantae is more horizontally oriented 9 times out of 10 than vertically oriented, you're gonna get a...
He says in a vertical room.
That's why I said 9 times out of 10. Like, Metroid, I'd say, is more evenly distributed between vertical areas and horizontal areas. Shantae is much more horizontal than vertical, so you don't need infinite jumping like you do in Metroid for it to be substantial.
There goes that backflip saving.
Yep.
Backflip and
which,
then you
again,
go into a...
that restores your triple jump.
Oh, yeah. So you can do obnoxious things if you take advantage of it, I'm guessing?
If something's really high in the air, I would suppose. Like, if you were to use your triple jumps and something's high in the air and it knocks you back and then you backflip and then use another set of jumps, then yeah, I suppose you can use it for something if there is a purpose.
Yeah.
If not, just a fun little tidbit.
Squid. Yeah, this room, I believe, is optional. You actually don't need to get the key in that room that I got a couple of bits ago, but it does make backtracking an awful lot quicker, so I recommend it.
How many layers do we have left?
How many... What do we have left?
You're closing in. I think you're...
A little less than 8 minutes in this part.
No. Not the part itself.
Well,
I
have less than 8 heart squids left because I've got 2... 2 containers left. Yes. After Frostbite Island, and I do all of my backtracking and crap before we get to the end of the game, so... we're gonna be covering all of that before we... before we go to the final area.
Oh. I gotta get to that locked door so fucking fast!
Well...
Combo breaker.
Combo breaker. I believe you have to crawl on the second step.
The top on the right. No, the top area.
Yeah.
That is... What is it with the red herring secret passages?
It's just a dick with you, really. Oh, wait, is that another one that you could just contra jump down?
I don't think you can, no.
Well, you can contra jump on any of those, like, pass-through surfaces, yeah. Essentially. So, like, I don't see why you wouldn't be able to do it there.
I didn't know you can dash through the ice blocks.
You didn't?
No, my first playthrough? No. I timed it so that I would begin my pirate dash before the ice block would fall back down to the conveyor belt, but second playthrough, I ran it through it accidentally, and it's like, oh, I'm a dumbass.
I still keep on thinking that there's something up there where the ice blocks fall down. There isn't.
No.
But it seems like there should be, right?
But hey, that just means you're curious.
Oh, man. Noob trap.
But good, we're at the boss.
And they're finally being courteous
enough.
Okay,
why did they give you one little heart next to one big heart?
I think they're actually...
In case you wouldn't heal yourself, but not too much.
Oh, this is the best one in the game. Steel Maggot, patent pending. Now
this is a pretty easy boss, though.
Yeah, like Metal Slug.
Yeah, but it's... But patent pending is my favorite part. Now, I believe you have to do the left one, then the right one, then the middle one in order to actually damage this thing. I think it might actually be the back one, then the front one, then the middle one more accurate.
I don't know if it's random or if it's set.
No, it's always been the same pattern: back, then front, then middle. And you have to use the cannonball as opposed to the
scimitar.
To the scimitar for some reason. Once you figure out the combo, though, this boss is pretty easy. Again, yeah. I hadn't played the game in a while, and this was only my second or third playthrough, so that's why I'm making. It's taken me a little bit longer. I'm just not as familiar with the game.
Definitely not as hard as Daggron.
Oh no, Daggron. This is actually the boss difficulty is a little bit kind of out of whack. Really, like I don't the final boss is really the only one that gives me any trouble. Yeah, but you know, yeah. So once you do that, you can open up its tail and then just go to town.
Okay.
Oh, I think after the first round, it's a different set, but it's always back.
It changes after every round.
But it's always back, front, then middle. So if you use like a super monster milk, then you're always gonna be fine because you'll kill it within one set of whips. So it's like a 30-second boss if you know what to do.
Well.
All those proteins in that monster milk, baby.
Is there a reason we're doing the spinning in the air thing like we were in Risky's Revenge?
Tradition.
Yeah, you also spun in place in Shantae 1.
Yeah, probably tradition. It was really only there in Shantae 1 to show off how fluidly the sprite animation moved, so I think it's just sort of a holdover from that, really.
Should have bought a jacket before coming here.
Yeah, I think I do all of my backtracking at once, so I don't go back to Propeller Town until after we do stuff on the last island. Yes.
Risky's age was always a point of debate. They never really describe how old she is.
Well, she's older than Shantae, but...
Yeah. I always figured she was... You know, it's also the art style.
Yeah.
Where she's probably maybe in her 30s or possibly early 40s. I always figured she was a little older. Not because... obviously, she doesn't really have any features that distinguish any sort of maturity, but if you look closely, and it's easier to notice in the HD version, the bottom of her eyes, she has dark lines.
Kind of a shadowy look, yeah.
Yeah, I never took that as makeup. I always took that as age.
Like yeah, Christmas. I kind of get the idea that Shantae is probably a late teens, early 20s kind of equivalent.
I think Shantae's 16.
16? Okay.
I think I remember reading that somewhere, yeah.
Yeah, she's... I always got the idea that that Risky was in her 30s, like maybe early to mid-30s. Because she still has to be young enough to be sexy, don't you know? Once you turn 40, then you're just like an old grandma in
yeah, it's Risky Boots, not Risky MILF.
The thing about art styles like this is that when they want to convey age, they usually do it by facial expression rather.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah, it's a very minor detail, but it's enough for me to think that she's in her 30s.
And they talk about Risky knowing Shantae's mom, so she has to be old enough for that at the very least.
Oh dear.
Yeah, this
Zombie,
is the
it's a pirate zombie.
Pirate zombie ghost thing. So, wow. Yeah. So here we learn that the pirate master does actually have a reason to be pissed off because Risky betrayed him.
And she's wearing his face.
Yeah. Well. Wait, like literally wearing his face, or
yeah.
Like
it's her top end belt.
Oh.
He even comments on it. Like right here, I think he comments on it.
I thought he's like. No, I thought he meant, like, wear her face, like, have his face as her face. And I was like, what? But, oh, like, wear his face like her clothes. Oh, yeah. Okay. That makes an awful lot more sense.
That's kind of dark.
Yeah, a little bit. So, yeah, now...
She kind of tried to trade me for her safety.
We get a boat!
I've asked you what, dogs. It's time to swab the plate.
Oh, now she's playing it pirate. Risky just got kidnapped by an evil pirate zombie, and she's playing it pirate.
Well, yep. I mean, like, come on. Risky was all like, no being a pirate, Shantae, and now she's got a chance to do whatever the fuck she wants. So.
No, it's Shantae's revenge.
Oh, man.